the seminar for a pesticide prioritization model, and there I will show you how to use the model and also introduce the science behind the interface. It was developed by the prioritization work group in the PR circuit water program. Shane, Rob, Mike, April, and me. It was significantly contributed by our scientific aid for data collection and data analysis. We also appreciate our reviewers and consultants inside and out of DPR for their critical comments and discussion. Today, we mainly focus on the most recent development of watershed scale prioritization, but I also cover the early stage studies, including the phase 1 and phase 2. So the demonstration will be one of the major parts. Water monitoring of the pesticide, obviously we cannot sample everywhere, anytime, for everything. So prioritizing this will be a good idea for us to optimize our project design and also make use of our limited resources. Slide from a regular model development project is kind of experience-based. It's developed based on the lower experience for previous monitoring project. Ask ourselves the question, what are the factors or the considerations or the ideas in our previous in 2007, at least two factors are identified, including the pesticide toxicity and the pesticide use. So already something like a priority list. This approach is really useful, but not very efficient because of the manual calculation and the professional-based judgment. So first, expected that to make this this process more efficient with a one-click solution. In 2012, the prioritization work group was developed in order to establish computer programs to integrate and facilitate the mission of updating the agriculture and urban monitoring priority list. So the real idea is that we just try to translate those components in our previous the effort for the process into a more mathematical, more systematic processes, so we can have more and transparent processes for the monitoring prioritization. Actually, early stage or the phase one study is just to use the priorities that I just shown. So with exactly the same factors, including the pesticide use and the pesticide toxicity. We found some problems. For example, the pesticide used is not equal to the pesticide exposure to surface water. So we try to introduce more factors to identify the predicted or observed exposure potential. I mentioned that this is not a real process modeling to quantify the level of the exposure potential, but just a descriptive classification. So, for example, classify the exposure into a high exposure potential or the low exposure potential. In addition to that, the phase three study is designed to improve the spatial resolution because the phase one and the phase two are mounting based. But obviously, for our surface water monitoring, maybe a watershed is a better spatial resolution. There is a computer program was developed for all of those phases, and those documents have been posted online in the link show, and the computer program will be available soon. So the final product is something very different from what we expected at the very beginning. So basically, we do this step by step. We finished something and found some problem and have more improvement, and also continue this process. Start with the model program. Basically, there are two files in this program, including a prioritization.exe. This is a small executable file. And there's another one called data.dat. This is a supporting database, including two parts. The first one is the system data, including something like the pesticide property, information, and some index tables for the PUR. And this one is the real PUR data, simplified and reformatted, which is organized per year. So, for example, there are about 200 megabytes per year. Our to provide two different versions for our DPR internal version. This file includes the most 3 years of PUR data. And mentioning that the new data for the year of 2013 was recently released during the development of this presentation. So I have time to revise everything in the talk. So for the demonstration purpose, I will keep using the 3 years of 2010 to 2012, but that the new data is available. Third version, if the online posting will have some limitations for the data file size, I would like to exclude those PUR data. So that means the users have to import their own PUR data after downloading this program. And of course, there are some intermediate and result files. So I treat the model development as simple as possible. So for example, there is no requirement for the installation. You just copy the file and you can run that. And there is no requirement for some special system configuration. For example, you have to install ArcGIS in your computer. And finally, there is no requirement for the administrative permission. This could be a problem for most of us. And there is one more thing I want to share with you about the model development. It's the separation of the methodology and the input data. So the two files actually represent two major components in the model development. The EXE file is for the modeling approach or the methodology, and the DAT file is for the model application or the input data. So separating the methodology from the input data, we have a better control on those the data part. So we have some built-in data for the model application, but for advanced users, if they do have their own version of the something like the property or the water data or even the pesticide use data, they can have their own data incorporated into the model without any change on the methodology. So will be a quick introduction on the user interface. So and we have a default settings. Before there are two for just click on the pluralization.exe the interface. And at this time it's covered by the shared desktop. There's a version number of 3.0. And there is one more thing very important, the help file. This time it's still in the version of the 2.5, and I will update that soon. You can see there are three pages or called tabs in the interface, including the basic configuration, advanced options, and for the water prototype. So in the tab, the basic configuration, you ask to define your own pesticide use pattern, include the agriculture use, herbicides, or soil and their combinations. So, I want to specify the years of PUR data. So, in time, I specified the three most recent 3 years, and it's very important to check the data available in the building database. So, that in the current database, I have the 4 years data. So if you have you want the prioritization use data out of this range, you have to download or import data by yourself. I mentioned that soon. So existing data, there are many options such as the acute, chronic. For surface water prioritization, we mainly use the US EPA aquatic life benchmark, and also supplemented by the benchmark equivalent developed by our surface water program. So I will give more information for that soon. So with any change on the interface, I just click on the prioritize. So this is the first model run, so just give more time for the it's warm up. Before the here's the results. The results will be displayed in the HTML format and basically include the two major parts. The first is the summary of the, your input options. After that, there is a table, which is basically the priority list. The options, for example, you can download the priority list in Excel format. So click on that and open in Excel. So it's just the same in the web page. And this part just to summarize some of your selections and options. For example, for this default run with agriculture use pattern and 3 years of data, and also shows the version of the PUR data. This is because sometimes the PUR data may be updated. So compare your results, you better compare the version of the input data. And also the information for the toxicity data type and the sources. And here's the description of the use data. As you can see, there are hundreds of chemicals, I mean the pesticides, but only the top 15 displayed based on the option here. So there is an option you can change it to the maximum number of the top pesticides for reporting. So I will close the look into the priority list. The list including the chemical code, chemical name, and the use data. The use data is just the annual average based on the years you specified in the program. So the impound will be translated into a user score from 1 to 5, and benchmark or toxicity data will be translated into a toxicity score from 1 to 8. And the final score for the prioritization is product of the use score and the toxicity score. So for chlorpyrifos, the final score is equal to 5.6 for the use score and toxicity score respectively. The priority list just ordered by the final score. Information for the each of those scores. Toxicity score equal to 1 for low toxicity to a higher toxicity. So basically we classify the toxicity in the order of 10, and compared to the use data, toxicity data is easy to classify, is classified because of the data are generally static compared to the use data because it changes from species to species but never change because of the year, county, or months. So that means we can use the fixed values for the of the classification. But use data is totally different because it's dependent on the user defined use pattern, the year, the region, the county, or the month. So for the classification purpose, we proposed a approach. So that means if we have 100 pesticides, we just calculated the annual use and divided by the total use. Then the top two chemical or the two of the 100 pesticides will be classified with the use score. And the next 4% will be classified as the use score 4. So those percentiles are default use and can be changed by users. But I should mention that those are not random numbers. Those are carefully designed based on the assumption of the log-normal distribution of the use data. So if you want to change those numbers, you should have a good reason. And the next slide will show some of the input data and options. And the PUR data is the most important. Can be downloaded from internal database or just imported from the PUR website or the FTP. So this has been shown before, just to show the what are already included in the built-in data. If the data is not available, you should download or import from different sources. So internal downloading requires for the configuration, and those are available in the user's menu. So in the Appendix 1 system configuration for the Oracle connection, this provides very detailed information for the internal database connection. So you need an Oracle drive code in your computer and also the ODBC connection. And of course, you should have the PU-based account. Because this is a computer for presentation, I cannot demonstrate this process. And if you don't have a PUR account or you don't have the connection to the Oracle database, you can still use the option for import PUR data. So just download the data from the FTP and zip that data and use the this program to import the data from the text files. In the program, there are many options for the PUR data processing, including we already introduced the use pattern, years, and also the county, month, and of course watershed. For data, we mainly use the US EPA benchmark, aquatic life benchmark, and the chemicals, no benchmark data available. We will tend to the footprint database. So for this purpose, we calculated the toxicity data from footprint PPBD to in the exactly the same format as the US EPA benchmark. So we call this benchmark equivalent. And please mention that those two databases are not unavailable. That means the benchmark equivalent is actually just in addition to the US EPA benchmark. That means if for one pesticide, if the data is already available for its benchmark, the benchmark equivalent won't be used. Include additional data, including the human health benchmark and the drinking water standards, but at this time, we not really use those data. And for the type of toxicity data, we have acute, chronic, and both. This is a new function, actually, from our reviewers. So that means we will consider both the data from the acute toxicity and the chronic toxicity and use the lowest one. Properties, we currently use the IOPAC footprint pesticide property database, and but this database is invisible to users. That means there is no difference in the interface. For the monitoring data, we are using the surface, our surface water database or SURF. Actually, in the current version, we also include data from USGS and water boards. But in the future, after the update of our SURF database, this will be the only source for the monitoring data analysis. It's one option for the database analysis. So basically, you can specify one monitoring site or just for every site in one county, and the program will report the frequency and benchmark exceedance for you. This is a demonstration for DPR surface water monitoring in Pierre County. So in this county, we have more than 10 monitoring sites, meaning for agriculture uses. And according to our monitoring PI, the prioritization should be conducted for January to March. I will also show you the data analysis for the historical monitoring results for all sites in this county. So by the way, this county is indicated by the CA County Code of Sorting. Go to the program, and the agriculture is enacted. And for other options, I enable the county region-based prioritization. And you can just type in the county code, or you can use this little helper, and I just select the county. Also enable the month season-based prioritization. So for this demo, I will only use the data for the January to March. Enable the data-specific analysis for the historical monitoring data. So this time, I will run the model for all sites in the county of the Imperium. And that's it. So just a run. So to save our time, I copied the results into the slide. And as you can see, different from the statewide prioritization, the results will show you the rate of interest, also the months of interest. And it's mentioned that the historic shows the real results. And it's also mentioned that the historical model monitoring data analysis for this county is reported at the detection frequency and benchmark exceedance. So those are two columns for this purpose. So for propyrobots, there are 22 samples with the user specified year. And those samples are detected. And the three of samples above the benchmark. And the benchmark is also according to the user specified toxicity database. That means you can change your selection of the toxicity data to change the benchmark evidence. So those information will be really helpful for our monitoring EI to make a refined decision for each of the specific monitoring sites. And in the results, you may also notice that there is a one more column called a monitoring recommendation. This is for the refinement of our phase one study and for the phase two refine the priority list. So,
sorry, I didn't catch that. What does it mean when that says false?
So this is called a monitoring recommendation. True means that this chemical is recommended for monitoring. And false means this is not recommended for monitoring purpose. More information. The purpose is to classify the pesticide with relative exposure potential to surface water and make recommendations for monitoring. So, for this is not a real process-based modeling, but just give a relative comparison between the exposure potentials. So, we currently defined the observed exposure potential, which is based on the monitoring data, and also define the predicted exposure potential based on the chemical data, use and application method. And the approach is very similar to the surface water registration evaluation model. With the registration model, you know, the results are presented as something like it's called a registration recommendations, including support or rejection or continual support, something like that. So this is very similar to the monitoring recommendations. Here, the true means that this has potentially caused surface water toxicity and should be included for monitoring. And for the if it's false, that means it's recommended to exclude it for the monitoring. For the exclusion, it also provides the specific reasons. Should be the previous demonstration. So the second link, the first link is for the Excel format of the priority list, and the second link is to the detailed information for the monitoring recommendation. So if I just click that, and you can see there are many reasons for exclusion, something like a short persistence in water, or the soil potential is low, or the bioavailability is low, and some are here. So the pesticide products are registered with low risk use pattern or low risk application methods. So those are potential reasons for exclusion. And moving to watershed scale prioritization, I should mention the proposed schedule of the database updating. For our data, basically we just update that when the new data is available, and this also can be done by users. So they can update the database if you want. And for the USDP benchmark, basically we proposed to have a annual updating. And for example, the most recent update is in this. And the number of database, the database when a new version is released. Here is about the chemical property. So there is no specific plan for the updating of the chemical property. Currently, we are using the footprint database, and but we will keep an eye on the change on the database or if there is any a new database available for our inclusion. For the watershed, phase one and phase two, those are mainly based on the county. But we think that for surface water monitoring, maybe watershed scale could be a better spatial resolution, not because of more watershed included compared to the county, but also the reason that for the pesticide detection in one monitoring site, it could be counted by the pesticide application miles or even hundreds of miles away. As a hydrologist, I believe that watershed hydrology is the central part for everything about the environmental risk assessment, up to the global circulation and down to the groundwater remediation. A watershed is defined as the area draining to one stream, actually to one stream alternate. It's also called a pore point. And, any drop of water received within the watershed will be transported into the watershed alternate before it can be translated to a downstream watershed. So there is no chance for a drop of water jump between two watersheds before flowing into the watershed alternate. And it could be zero that for the headwater to multiple in water inlets. A wide watershed system should minimize this number, the number of the inlets. If you have too many inlets, you may consider increase your number of water structures is within and between the watershed. Within the watershed, there are main streams which will be contributed by both the local watershed and the upstream watershed, and also the tributary streams, which is only contributed by the local sources. And for the time of tribal, and that means that it takes some time for a drop of water from maybe a remote location in the watershed to the watershed alternate. And between watersheds are flow direction and flow accumulation. So at this scale, we are mainly talking about the upstream-downstream relationship. It's also called the front-to relationship. So basically, you can define your own watershed by just defining the inlet, alternate, or the combinations. But it's better to start with some supervised watershed system, such as the USGS hydrological unit system. So as you can see, the this system just divided the entire United States into hydrological regions. It's indicated by two-digit hydrological unit code, or called HUC2. So for yeah, the HUC2 value is equal to 18. And it's very interesting that California may be the only state in which the boundary of the hydrological region just follows the boundary of the state. So that means we are isolated hydrologically. Mm-hmm. Just go to the website. It's called the USGS National Map Viewer to get more information about the hydrological system. So this is two maps. Okay. So the focus on California. Why you mean the map will be a next level HUC system. It's called HUC4. The first two digits are actually taken from the HUC2, and there are more information for the HUC4. So here is the San Joaquin Basin, and the Sacramento Basin, and this is the mainly for the Salinas River Basin. So continue to zoom in, and get more information. It's called HUC 8. And you can see that there is a jump from HUC 4 to HUC 8. There is no space to HUC 4, HUC 6. So I will give more explanation for that. And HUC 8 is a milestone in the system because this is a well-defined and very reliable data. And it's also reflect the major rivers, major famous rivers. For example, we have a Tuolumne River basin here, and the Masaya River, and the Salinas River. So can you get a question of HAC 10 and then HAC 12? So phylo or the fines, the resolution for California. For other states, other locations, there are even higher resolution, but for California, HAC 12 is our modeling units. So here just already showed in the viewer, we have a HAC 2 and HAC 6, 8, 10, and 12. There are some statistics for the EDU system. The national statistics are just taken from the USDP report, US report, and also provided a version for the California total number of the units. As you can see, for HAC 4 and HAC 6, there are major differences in terms of the average size and in terms of the total number of the units. That's why this escaped in the map viewer. And anyway, we will mainly focus on the which is for the water, HAC 12. It's called a sub-watershed, but in this study, we just call it a watershed. In California, there are 4,415 HAC 12. And the in the California hydrological region. And see, there are some of those HAC 12 actually located out of California state, but those, I mean, there is no PUR data for those watersheds, but it still contributes water into a downstream monitoring site. And also some location which is in the state of California, not really in the hydrological region. So here, on the corner of the Riverside County, we have some modified. And for this purpose, we will introduce the customized watershed delineation, and I will show that soon. One of the watershed, it's the Upper Salinas River. Salinas River just originated here and flowed to the northwest. And the process is joined by meeting the tributaries. So as I mentioned before, the HAC 12 will be the minimal spatial unit for modeling. Minimal unit means that it's basically considered as one point, so there is no internal structure. The only thing we try to identify is the monitoring site on a mainstream or on a tributary. So for mainstream, it will receive water and pesticide from both the local watershed and also the upstream watershed. And for tributaries, it's only contributed by the local sources. And there might be multiple HAC 12 are involved as a contributing watershed, but for tributaries, there is only one. Negativity is designed by the front-to relationship. It's also the upstream-downstream relationship. And here the explanation for the PUR data aggregation from section level to HAC 12. So obviously this is only for the agriculture because agriculture PUR data has resolution and the section. So basically we define the watershed based on the section and just to get the PUR data in each of those sections and then find the total value. So it's very easy to describe, but not that easy for the computational implementation because it takes enough time, especially for a larger watershed. And for the urban, there is no way to downscale urban pesticide use because it's reported in a resolution. So, for example, if you have a pesticide use in Sacramento River, Sacramento County, I cannot estimate the pesticide used in a specific residential community. But rough estimation is possible with the in that PUR data can be downscaled and proportionally to the population density. So here's an example. So that means if there is a community or there is a district in Sacramento County, and which covers 10% of the total Sacramento County population, then it's assumed that this district or this community will use 10% of the reported urban data in Sacramento County. So this fraction, the F value present, and if multiple counties in one, there will be additional terms. So to purpose, we introduced a resolution, an intermediate resolution called the county subdivision, which is just between the county resolution and the HAC 12 resolution for the conversion. So basically, the pesticide use will be scaled to the county subdivision level and then to the watershed level. We already have the pesticide use for each of the HAC 12. We can calculate the total PR uses. So for each of the monitoring sites, we first determine the drainage area and then give a list of the contributing HAC 12. So for the sites, there is only one HAC 12, and for the mainstream sites, there may be multiple, including the base HAC 12 where the site is located and all the upstream watershed. For the user input data to define a monitoring size, there are two factors. The first is called a base valve, that means where the site is located. And then it's also should to tell the computer if the site is located on a mainstream or it's just on a tributary. So in this time, we already have the data for each of the watershed and also have the a list of the contributing watersheds. So the question is to how to calculate the total use. So the easiest way is just to get a simple sum by get a total value of the pesticide uses in each of the contributing HAC 12s. And to refine this calculation, we introduced the time of tribal. So that means we will consider the tribal time from one specific watershed to the outlet or the monitoring sites. So T is for the tribal time, and K is for the pesticide dissipation rate constant. So that means the D value is the action based on first order kinetics for the pesticide dissipation during the time of tribal. So, and this is the refinement or improvement compared to the original same total value. This is an improvement to the original assumption, but still a really rough estimation for the pesticide uses, because the more refined calculation, we have to use some process-based modeling process. So the value of the time of travel can be derived from a database called HD Plus. And this is a database is developed by both the US EPA and the USGS, including many for each of the one and the HAC 12 level. This is not only a demonstration, but also a real monitoring prioritization study. So basically, we try to prioritize the pesticide uses in the Salinas River and Del Monte Road. And this is mainly for the agricultural uses from April to September. Those are defined by our monitoring project, the PI. So as mentioned before, there are two major factors to define the watershed. The first one is the base HAC 12. So if you have ArcGIS, it's relatively easy to you to locate the site into the HAC 12. If you don't have that, we still use the map viewer. So this might just copy the search the UGS map viewer. You can locate your monitoring site. And of course, you can get your HAC 12 here. obviously, this is not a tributary, it's a mainstream and contributed by so many, at least 100 stream watersheds. Modeling purpose, I make sure the agriculture is enacted and the county is not really used, but there are different selection of months from April to September. And one option, I enable the watershed-based prioritization and use the HAG-12-based delineation. There are some built-in sites and many for our DPR agriculture monitoring. So for demonstration, this is for the Salinas River and the Del Monte Road. And of course, you can define that manually to just type the HAG 12 and also make sure they are for the located on a mainstream it's connected. That's just a round model. So the result has been presented in the monitoring protocol. And you can see there is a column called monitoring inclusion. Yes means that we are here. And this should be unchecked. I forgot to uncheck that. This is for the previous one. So basically, the yes means that we will include this pesticide in the monitoring. And pending means that the analytical method is still development, but will be included soon. And those nodes means this excluded from our monitoring. Recently developed, actually last week, to even simplify silo report list. So you can see this time even we already used the total maximum of the top pesticide for reporting, there are still so many chemicals in the list. So we try to get a phylo version or a clean version for our monitoring purpose. So option to only report a pesticide recommended for monitoring. And with the user's specific data for the phylo score and user score, those values are actually from the study of protocol. You can change that for your own purpose. So if I in this option, and we will get a even shorter list, and which is exactly the same as what I presented here. So there are about 10 chemicals, yellow or clean version of the priority list. For the urban receiver, and I used the site of for the South San Raymond Creek in Alameda County. So again, we try to locate the monitoring site by copy the and search in the map viewer. And HAG-12, the base HAG-12. As you can see, this is a tributary because the mainstream is here and receive more input from upstream watershed. So I just use HAG-12. Make sure I won't mess up. Thing to make sure I use the urban selected urban use rather than agriculture and. The demonstration, I just use the annual prioritization. And I change the in based on the HAG 12 of the specific site, and go uncheck the mainstream set option. Model. So, that is the results. As you can see, the top 10 model recommended pesticide compared to our previous modeling project. That means all of those top 10 has been included in the monitoring project. this is a good match between the monitoring results and our previous monitoring experiences. This is for the customized watershed. This is relative to the standard watershed delineation based on 12. So we don't have to think about the USGS watershed delineation, but just to define a watershed based on a list of sections. So that means this is only for agriculture. And we have a very specific purpose for the customized watershed. So first thing is that we have some of the monitoring sites are associated with a very small drainage. So the tributary of a tributary in the watershed. So I will give a demonstration soon. And the reason is that there are, in addition to the USGS national watershed delineation, we may have more local data, including the irrigation or the water diversion or the tailwater connection. So we have a better definition for the watershed. So in that case, we can just define the watershed by section rather than use the standard watershed delineation. Last one, I think I mentioned that there are some monitoring sites located in the state of California, but in the watershed of the Colorado River Basin. So in case I decided to have this customized watershed, so we don't have to develop a Colorado River watershed version of the prioritization. This example is for the Alisa Slough, which is a very small drainage area in the lower Salinas River Basin. As you can see, compared to the HAC 12, this area is just a very small fraction of the total area. So for the cost of the prioritization, the first thing is to give a list of sections for to define the drainage area. I have the available here, so the sections, the specific monitoring site. And so in the model, you just import this list for the prioritization. So make sure the agriculture is enacted and there is no more option for months. And for the watershed prioritization, I use the customized. So also there are some predefined modified, but this time I just import the list from the TXT file I just mentioned here. Model. So here shows the results, and this is very short because I selected here the simplified of the model results. But anyway, and this prioritization is just for with a drainage area of only 77 square kilometers. This is some for the model application. So once we have some input information, including the site location, water body type, aerial description, including the land use or the total area of the watershed contribution area, and sampling schedule and budget, we can have a better understanding and a better model application. So for example, we use most recent 3 years with PA data. And the months for prioritization will be consistent to the sample schedule. And for the water body type, there are some suggestions. And for drainage ditch, in the preferred method is based on the customized drainage area. If it's not available, you may have an estimation based on the prioritization to the tributary site. And for computing scale, monitoring for the storm outfall, there is no preferred or there is no perfect method. You can still have some rough estimation based on the prioritization for the tributary site. And water in a tributary of a watershed, agricultural or urban watershed, so it's suggested to use the prioritization for tributary site. And of course, for those major rivers, use the mainstream prioritization. Topic called spatial continuous mapping. So here is that if we can run the prioritization for one the monitoring site or one of the watershed alternate, we can still run the prioritization for each of those out of the watershed in the entire drainage area. So this is to compare the statewide space distribution of one chemical. So the comparison between the continuous mapping and the regular prioritization. So for continuous mapping, there is only one chemical. Of course, you can run that one by one, but essentially there is one chemical, but in multiple locations. Regular prioritization, there are so many chemicals, but there is only one predefined watershed or predefined monitoring site. Because there is only one chemical, there is no way to define use score based on the percentiles. So at this time, I use the actual used amount in a pound, and also normalized by the toxicity in P, and then normalized by the stream flow. If you are uncomfortable with the stream flow, you can still use the drainage area, which is well-defined. And the stream flow is also predicted in the database of the NHD+. It's the same database as we derived the tribal time. So the definition is for the continuous mapping for chlorpyrifos. So this is really easy. Just make sure the culture is enacted, no more option for months or something, and then select the option for the continuous, spatially continuous mapping, and input the code. So the results will be reported for the priority here already there, but just have more disruption here. So the results will be reported as the priority map index for each of the HAC 12. That means there are 4,409 of the values. The results will be available in two different formats. The Excel format is provided for some data analysis or the data collection, and also there is a JSON format which is provided for the data exchange with the GIS software. So to the results part, so the first link is to the download the results in Excel format, so we can just open that. And as you can see, there are more than 4,000 lines of data, and it's organized by the tributary and the mainstream. ACC is for the accumulated index. JSON format, essentially the same data, but formatted in the format which can be read by the GIS application. Desktop GIS applications such as ArcGIS, you can just have a better visualization for the results because one individual's results doesn't make any sense. So this at least gives us some idea for the distribution of the chlorpyrifos use over the California. ArcGIS, you can still have visualization based on some online map service. So here's an example for the POR. Hosted in UC Davis. And this is originally designed for the pure data visualization, but we are working with the UC Davis group to provide more options called user supplied values. This, with this option, we can just visualize our results in the online service. So let me try if I can do that because this service is not very stable. The JSON. Just in our previous demonstration here. And indexing the option for the user supplied value. Make some changes. This is for the different corner. Maybe right. And you can change the level of the corners. And change the classification method to get a map, something like this. And limitations. So At first, this mask is designed to give an initial screening level or the comparison between the different importance of the pesticide for surface water monitoring. It's not designed to quantify or predict the pesticide concentration in a river. So some components for prediction, but that's not only for the classification, the descriptive classification level. Into that, chemical properties are considered, but the physical processes are not really simulated. So we have some discussions on the balance between very detailed modeling and the spatial coverage at the very beginning of this project. So one is that we can have a very detailed field scale modeling for some selected pesticide and some selected monitoring site. And the option is that we have a more consistent framework for pesticide and in any location of California. Finally, we try to focus on the second option to just the distributed modeling framework first, and this framework can be used for our future development based on the field scale model. And so the limitations could be because of the input data. For example, PUR data, if you are really interested in the indoor use or the home use or swimming pool use, this model is not for you. And for the pesticide property database or the watershed database, there must be some problems or issues, especially compared to the California field condition. But this part, as mentioned before, it's weather control, either easy access. So that means we there are options in the interface or some options not really in the interface, but if you have some specific request, just let me know. I can easily incorporate it in the input database. We always try to include this slide because most of us, including myself, is not a monitoring project PI, but we can still use this model program for some different purpose. For example, it's a good tool for the R query and mapping. I know you guys are experts in SQL query, but this may save you some time. So here's just some example. I recently used this model for my own purpose of the PUR query. And this model compiled an up-to-date toxicity database, including the US EPA benchmark equivalent drinking water and human health. See that we are going to update the database regularly. And it's a tool for the data analysis. At least the program will report the frequency and benchmark exceedance in the user-defined domain, including the county or the site, and even you can define the different levels of the benchmark. Is the big picture. So current modeling development for surface water can be generally considered in two different directions. The one is for the registry evaluation before the pesticide is actually used in California, and of course the post-use evaluation after the real use. The major difference is that the registration evaluation is based on the label, the proposed label rate, and scenario-based, that means there is no survivability. And for the post-use evaluation, we already have the PUR data, so you can use the real use data for the evaluation. And for the registration evaluation, we already have the phase one and the phase two studies. And the prioritization process presented today is something equivalent to the phase one initial screening of the registration evaluation. There are many components actually shared by the both the monitoring, prioritization, and the phase one initial screening. But we also proposed a study called probability-based risk assessment, which is more equivalent to the phase two refined modeling. So at the time, we generally catched up with the national scale studies, and we also noticed that at least two national scale studies by US EPA for the spatial aquatic model and USGS monitoring prioritization. The content for those projects are that they are based on the detailed modeling of the risk quotient. So by the way, here shows the difference between the phase 1 and phase 2. So basically, those initial screening level is based on rough estimation of the risk quotient or the exposure potential. But for the refined modeling stage, to about the detailed modeling of risk quotient. So question, why, if there are already national scale studies, why we have to introduce the California-specific study? This is because the national level study sometimes means that it's for everyone except California. I'm kidding, because we realize that there are many good models developed and validated in other states but cannot be used for California. So the community already noticed this problem. So for both US EPA and the USGS, they have a very special study to develop a model and validate the model started from California. They try to use that to other states. So in the near future, California will be a hotspot for the modeling, both the development and application. So I try to collaborate and coordinate with those national studies and make sure the California field condition can be incorporated. A new program called a Surf Watershed. Just don't get confused about the Surf or Surf database. The idea is that US EPA thinks that before any risk assessment, the first thing that you should determine where you are in according to the watershed, and especially the HAC, it's used the HAC 8 and the. So that's all for today. And actually, I have, before questions, I would like to introduce something because we already have some time. And everything presented before is just a very surface component of this project. There are some more mathematics behind. So, history of the priority rankings, as you can see, for watershed or one molecule site prioritization, we use the priority score as a product of the use score and the toxicity score. But the spatial use the protein score, it's also called a mapping index, which is the use normalized by toxicity and then normalized by the stream flow. So you may ask the question how to define those scores and what's the difference or what's the connection or relationship between those two different formulations. So the mathematics behind the scores. Basically, the toxicity score is just a log transformation of the toxicity value, which is in ppb. For example, if you have a toxicity value of 1 ppb, then you will have a toxicity score of 5. And also, the use data or the use score is also a log transformation. It's not equal to, but related to the log transformation of the use data in pound. So this is based on assumption of a log-normal distribution of the pesticide use. Here's an example of the linear relationship between the use score and the percentile of the use data. That means both the toxicity score and the use score are nothing but just the log transformation of the toxicity value and the use value, respectively. So let's start with the risk quotient. It's defined the ratio of the concentration over toxicity. It's also called toxicity unit, toxicity index, or by USGS, the benchmark quotient. So concentration for monitoring purpose is usually used the average concentration in a water body, and the toxicity value is defined by users. So we can connect the different types of toxicity. So here are some mathematical processes. The concentration is equal to the divided by stream flow, and we don't have the pesticide loading in river, but we can use the pesticide use as an indicator for the pesticide load. So the risk quotient is not equal to, but related to the use normalized by flow and normalized by toxicity. So this is exactly the mapping index used in the prioritization. And this also provides some opportunity for multiple pesticide prioritization, because we can just get some of the use normalized by toxicity. One monitoring site prioritization, because the flow is a constant value, so this can be canceled. And the other reason is that because there are so many chemicals with a really wide range of toxicity data, so you make the risk quotient or the equivalent risk quotient value unmanageable. So for this purpose, just get a local transmission about the risk quotient, and then the risk quotient will be related to the user score. As mentioned before, this is just a log transformation of the use data and also the toxicity score. So we used the two scores to get a more spread phylo score. Because you can say if the user score is 1 to 5, toxicity score is 1 to 8, but plus we get a value up to 13. But by multiplication, we get a value up to 40. That means we get a better coverage of the phylo score. So are the mathematics behind the prioritization. Also provide some opportunity for us to improve the methodology by introducing one more factor called the loading as a percent of use. So in this case, this quotient will be equal to not only related, but equal to the LA value times use data and then normalized by flow and toxicity. So here's some example in the previous studies for this the APU value. For example, the USGS determined that the LA value for diazinon is about 0.17 in San Martin River. And we can also predict the LAPU value for each of the sections. Here shows the example for the chlorpyrifos and diazinon and chlorpyrifos in the Orsimba Creek. So just the proposed field study direction.
Hey,
yes.
How varies the loadingness percent of use value? Is it, we rely on one particular value, but is there variability with?
That's actually related to the field condition and also the years, the months, and different application methods. It's very specific to application, but I have some general idea. For example, the USGS that the diazinon could be something like 0.1 or between 1.2. So if you use 100 pounds diazinon in San Joaquin River watershed, you may get 0.17 pound of the chemical in the outlet of the San Joaquin Basin. So that's all for today, and I'm ready for